Right here in Ozobolo, near with 30 FM.
91.9.
Onisha Oka, once again, it's the Singles Mingle Youth Outreach International, a movement designed to impact the lives of youths through the systematic teaching of God's Word as it affects their spiritual, mental, social, and economic lives. This will in turn make them solutions to their generations. The Singles Mingle Youth Outreach focuses its assignments on career coaching, leadership development, relationship instructions, spiritual and mental empowerment, character formation, and marriage preparations. Do well to join the anointed couple, Venerable and Architect Mrs. Arinze Anene, as they ensure that I am a solution to my generation. Join us every second Sunday of every month for Singles Mingle Special Youth Summit. For prayers and counseling, call 080-339-16979. You can also worship with us at St. Stephen's Anglican Church, Umudim, Newi. Singles Mingle Youth Outreach. I am a solution to my generation.
Hello, good evening, my esteemed listeners. I want to welcome you again tonight to Singles Mingle Radio Broadcast, coming to you live from the studios of Authority FM 91.9. My name is Venerable Arinze Anene, coming your way again tonight. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you. We appreciate you for a day like this that you have given to us to be alive in the land of the living. Thank you for the numerous opportunities you are giving to us day by day to hear your word that will bring transformation and hope to our lives. And tonight, at this moment, you've given us another opportunity. Lord, I pray that your word will fall upon the pleasant places of our heart. I pray that the word that will come tonight will touch the men, will touch the women, will touch the young men, will touch the young women, will touch the children, will touch indeed everyone that is hooked up or listening tonight. Have your way, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm excited to be with you again tonight on this episode of Singles Mingle Broadcast. And for tonight, I shall be speaking on what I titled Correct Mentality for Correct Marriage. Correct Mentality for Correct Marriage. And I shall be speaking to the youths, especially tonight. So if you're a parent, you have your children, your young men, young ladies, youths who are not married, I'd like you to call them close to their radio. Call them on the phone and tell them to tune in right now to 91.9 FM, because the word that is about to come will bring change to their lives, revelations upon which they will act on, and then a change will come in their lives, especially as it has to do with their relationships. Now, I like us to read from the word of God, Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, and tonight I shall be reading from the version called Bible in Basic English. Genesis 2:18. And the Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be by himself. I will make one like himself as a help to him." It is not good for the man to be by himself. I will make one like himself as a help to him. Now, I'd like to remind you again tonight that marriage is the idea of God. Marriage is not the idea of a particular society, a particular culture. I have said this over and over again on this broadcast, that God is the one that instituted the institution of marriage, is the one that put it together. After the creation of man, God gave man an assignment to take care of the earth, of the garden, to tend it. After which God saw that it was not good for the man to be alone. I'm talking about Genesis 2, verse 15. God gave man work to do. And verse 18, God now said, I will make him a helper suitable for him. I'll make him somebody that will help him in the assignment I have given to him. Now, but we have discovered that today, several people have their opinions and mentalities about the institution of marriage. Young people grow up, some people grow up not knowing anything at all about marriage. Some grow up having a disjointed mentality about marriage. So for the time we have tonight, we want to look at several mentalities, wrong mentalities, erroneous mentalities that some persons have concerning the institution of marriage. But I need to remind you again that your mentality is can be defined as a characteristic way of thinking of a person. I remember here some weeks ago, I taught on the mentalities to avoid. So I defined that day. But for those of you who might be tuning in for the very first time tonight, I define mentality as a characteristic way of thinking of a person or a group. I'd like to also remind you that your mentality determines your possibilities. Your mentality determines your activities. The way you think determines the way you behave. No wonder the Bible says in Proverbs 23, verse 7, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 23, verse 7a, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Your behavior is a manifestation of your thought pattern. The way you behave, the way your character is only a reflection of your mindset, of your mentality, of what is inside. That's the reason why in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, the Bible says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Your mentality has a lot to do with your life. Now, some persons have some mentalities, bad mentalities, or perspective, or assumptions about marriage. We want to look at some of them quickly, address them, and then we go ahead into the correct mentality you should have towards marriage. Now, number one, mentality we want to look at tonight is some persons, a lot of young people, look at marriage as something to go into to avoid lust. They look at marriage as something to go into to avoid lust. Something to go into to have access to sex anytime that they want. Now, we see some persons, as a counselor, I have come across some persons that have come, and I'm asking them, why do you want to get married? And I've had some of them say, I want to get married because I cannot hold my body again. Now, I want to get married so that I can have a partner. I can be satisfied my sexual desire all the time. Now, that is good. That is one of the reasons for the purposes of marriage, actually. But that is not the main purpose of marriage. Because you can't be having sex morning, afternoon, night. Won't you have work to do? Won't you go to market? Won't you go for your business? Don't you have a job to do? Even if you are tired, you are an idle person, you discover that you don't have sex all day. So if having sex is the reason why you want to get married, then prepare to be disappointed, because by the time you get married and you have sex for one day, for 2 days, for 3 days, for 4 days, then you discover that you are tired of it. So if you have problem with lusts, Ask God to help you. Go to your pastor and share with him. Ask him to lead you, to guide you, to pray for you. And get yourself free from the spirit of lust. Because if you still have that spirit of lust and you get married, you get married, you discover that you will still not be satisfied with your spouse. If sex is the only cure, or marriage is the cure for lust, if marriage is cure for lust, then some persons will see in the Bible, David, for instance, wouldn't have gone into Bathsheba. Solomon, for instance, would have been satisfied, but Solomon married 700 wives and then 300 girlfriends. So I'd like to put it to you tonight that marriage is not the cure for lust. And those of you that are listening to me tonight that are hooked up under the influence of this message, I rebuke that spirit of lust. If you are there listening to me tonight and you have problem with lust, I bind that spirit, I cast that spirit out of your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Lust is a spirit. And what to do with this is to deal with it, cast it out, and you shall be free in the name of Jesus Christ. So deal with the problem of lust before you go into marriage, otherwise your marriage will crash. That's the reason why you will see some men today, they are married to beautiful wives, and yet the man is going after the housemaid. Married to a beautiful wife, yet the man is going after the secretary in the office. Married to a beautiful wife, yet the man is going after the clerk or the cashier in the office. The reason is not because the wife is not beautiful. The reason is because that man is under the affliction of a spirit of lust. And what to do with it, is to deal with it. So if you are listening to me tonight, deal with the spirit of lust. Deal with it. Deal with it, and God will help you in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, another wrong mentality why some persons get married or go into marriage is some persons say, I am of age. The lady will say, I am 22 or 23 or 25. And because of that, I know I am matured enough or I am of age to marry. The man will say, I am 27 or 30 or 35. And because of that, I am old enough to get married. Now, listen to me tonight carefully. It is not about being old enough to marry. Now, I believe you would have seen somebody 35 years of age, but with the mentality of a 15 years old. I believe we'd have seen somebody also 40 years, but behaving and thinking like somebody 17 years. And I also believe we'd have seen somebody that is 22 years, but with the maturity of 45 years. So it is not just about how old you are, it is about how matured you are. Now, the maturity are in different dimensions and categories. Number one, you must have mental maturity, mental stability. You must be stable mentally before you go into marriage so that you'll be stable enough to take decisions and then stand by the decision you've taken. Then you must also have what I call mental stability. Number one is mental stability. Number two is emotional stability. Emotional maturity, you must be matured emotionally. The ladies among you listening to me tonight, you must be matured emotionally. Because marriage, it is not for children. The Bible says, for this purpose, a man will leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one. The Bible didn't say, therefore, a boy shall leave his father and mother and be joined to a girl. No, marriage is not for boys and girls. Marriage is for men and women. And as I said before, it is not just about how old you are, but it is about how matured that you are. So you need emotional stability, you need mental maturity, you need to be matured enough to take decisions and take responsibility of your decisions. Especially those of you that are young men listening to me tonight. Some people get married and they only know how to get their wives pregnant, but they don't know how to take care of the woman, you know, throughout the period of pregnancy. And then if, God forbid, there is a case of complication at the point of delivery and there is a need for a surgery, a CS to be undertaken, and the man is called to come and sign one or two things, the man will be running away. I've seen a man like that before. So he should be matured enough to take responsibility of your decisions and then stand by it. Now, another mentality, that's wrong mentality that some people have for getting into marriage, is there's some people see marriage as what to do to go, what to go into to get domestic assistance, especially the men among them. Some men feel that I want to marry. You ask him, why do you want to marry? He say, I need somebody that will be washing my clothes for me. I need somebody that will be cooking for me. I need somebody that will be going to market for me. I need somebody that will be shopping for me and the rest of them. No. Much as we know that when you get married, your spouse, your wife will be helping you out in those areas of life. But that alone is not the purpose, not the reason, not the main reason why you get married. Because you can still take care and receive assistance in these areas without getting a wife. For instance, you can take your clothes to the laundry, to like dry cleaner to do for you. You can get the assistance of, you can go to, these days there are people that cook soup and make stew and they sell. You can get those things if the reason for getting married is just for somebody that will be helping you in your domestic issues. There are some persons also have a housemaid mentality, slavery or housemaid mentality. They see themselves, I am old enough to be served. I need somebody to serve me. And watch out the men that have this mentality, when they go into marriage, their wives suffer a lot. Because they believe that they are getting married to a woman, everything is now all about him. The woman will do everything for him, serve him, answer him some morning, afternoon, night, and all the rest of those. But that alone is not the correct reason to go into marriage. Now, another reason why some persons go into marriage, especially the ladies among the ladies, is that some ladies, they believe that, or they think that marriage is what to go into to run away from parental control. They think, I am tired. Maybe their parent used to wake them up 5 a.m. or thereabout, and the lady is saying, I'm tired of all this control. I'm tired of all this pestering. Every time somebody's waking up by 5 a.m. and sweeping and doing these chores and washing the place and washing the clothes and all that, I want to get married so that I'll be in my own husband's house and I can wake up anytime I want, do anytime anything I want to do, and eat anything I want to do. I want to eat. You know, the reason why I'm laughing is because you lady, you are getting it all wrong. I want to say to you that marriage is work. Marriage is work. Marriage is hard work. What you know, this thing I just mentioned now, wake up anytime you like, eat anything you like, those things are only possible during honeymoon. You can do that during honeymoon. By the time after wedding and all that few days or that few weeks and all that, your husband will just pamper you and all that, give you breakfast in bed, take you out, you eat out in the morning for breakfast, eat out in the afternoon for lunch, eat out at night, going from one joint to the other, from one eatery to the other. Okay, it might be okay, maybe for the first few days, after the first few days of your marriage, but after that, you need to settle down in your home and build your home. Marriage is work. Marriage is hard work. And if you don't work at it, it will not work out. It will not work out. In marriage, you are accountable to your spouse. You are accountable to your spouse. Even the man, if you might say, I am the man, I have married a wife, I can go out and come in anytime I like. It's not true. It's not true. You are accountable. You go out to tell your wife where you are going to. You go out to tell your husband where you are going to. And by the way, I like to pause a little bit to talk to the men that are listening to me tonight. You know, some men think that because you are the man in the home, you can go anywhere you want to go without letting your wife know. Some men feel that women are not good enough to be told where to go. I want to say to you that some men are lost. I had a story about a man going out of the house. The wife asking him, where are you going to? The man said, I'm coming. This happened some years ago. He said, I am coming. And up till now, the man has not come. Happened years ago. The man left the house. If he was kidnapped, nobody was aware. If he was killed, nobody was aware. If he went east, west, north, and south, the wife was not aware. So, men, listen to me tonight. One of the reasons why you should let your wife know where you're going to is so that if there is any problem, I'm going to see where Chobagi. I'm going to direction see where Chobagi. But if you just go out anytime, at times some men say, I'm going to Onitsha, but they are going to Owerri and all that. You don't know what you are doing to yourself. You are accountable to your spouse. In fact, the ladies among you, I like to remind you, when you get married, you are accountable so much so that you even account for your thoughts. At times, your wife will be asking you, honey, what are you thinking about? Can you imagine that? You account for what you do, account for what you say, and even account for what you are thinking. So marriage is not just a bed of roses. So if the reason why you want to get married as a lady is because, let me just get married, go to my husband's house, and then relax and be free, then I assure you, you will be disappointed. I want to go on a break. When I come back, I shall be opening the phone lines to pray for you and answer your questions. Remember, it is still Venerable Arinze Anene, the Vicar of St. Stephen's Anglican Church, Umudim Newi, coming to you live from the studios of Authority, 91.9 FM, Ozobolo Newi. Remember, our services tomorrow at St. Stephen's Church, Umudim Newi, we have two powerful services in the morning, 6:30 a.m. and 9:30 a.m. Make up your mind to join us in any of those services. I shall be ministering in those services tomorrow by God's grace, and you might just have the opportunity of meeting me one-on-one, and then I'll be ministering to you by the message of God. Just don't touch that dial. I shall be back in a minute to continue with the message.
Onisha Oka, once again, it's the Singles Mingle Youth Outreach International, a movement designed to impact the lives of youths through the systematic teaching of God's Word as it affects their spiritual, mental, social, and economic lives. This will in turn make them solutions to their generations. The Singles Mingle Youth Outreach focuses its assignments on career coaching, leadership development, relationship instructions, spiritual and mental empowerment, character formation, and marriage preparations. Do well to join the anointed couple, Venerable and Architect Mrs. Arinze Anene, as they ensure that I am a solution to my generation. Join us every second Sunday of every month for Singles Mingle Special Youth Summit. For prayers and counseling, call 080-339-16979. You can also worship with us at St. Stephen's Anglican Church, Umudim Newi. Singles Mingle Youth Outreach. I am a solution to my generation.
Okay, I'm so glad to know that you are still there listening to our teaching tonight on Singles Mingle radio broadcast. Now, I've been talking on the topic correct mentality for correct marriage, and I have said a number of things. Before I open up the phone line to receive your questions, or you want me to pray for you concerning your marriage, you're a young person, you are having difficulties in your marriage and all that, or even if you are married, you're having difficulties in your marriage, you want me to pray for you too, I'll agree with you in prayer in a short while, and I'm going to believe God that God will touch your life, touch your marriage, even touch your body if you're sick, and then give you a testimony. Now, before I open on the phone line, I'd like to also throw this challenge to you. You know, there are some persons, they have this mentality, some young people, they said, I don't need to bother myself about acquiring knowledge or skills about marriage because of the grace of God and the Holy Ghost will teach me when I marry and all that. Now, listen to me. There is what we call premarital training, and there's what we call postmarital training. If you are about to enter into marriage, you shouldn't enter into marriage as a novice. What do I mean by that? Now, can I ask you this question? How many books have you read about marriage? Young man, young lady, a lady you are preparing to wed in December. You know, I don't know what has come over the young people now. You know, there is this thing they call somebody wants to get married, they call it a premarital shower or whatever. Call the friends and all that, and they are snapping pictures and enjoying themselves and all that. Wait, you are enjoying yourself, you are snapping pictures and posting on social media, and you have not read any book on marriage. I was about to conduct the wedding of a particular couple. 2 days to the time, I asked them, how many books on marriage have you read? The man told me none. The woman told me none. How can you be preparing to get married and you have no idea about what marriage is about. Some people, the only thing they know about marriage is what they have watched on holy, on the movies. You know, going from Nollywood to Hollywood to Bollywood to Gollywood. By the way, I don't know why they call them woods. You keep going from one wood to the other. No wonder some people are having wounds in their body. Because not anymore here can marry from this wood to that wood or to that wood to the other wood. And at the end of the thing, at the end of the day, they form their opinion about marriage based on what they are watching. But can I inform you that those things are acting? They are acting out a script. The things you see on TV, on the movies, they are not the correct way of life. You see somebody on a movie, you know, going nude and exposing the body. That's not the way to live. If you have been building, you know, your idea or concept of marriage based on all those things, I bet you that you are getting it wrong. So, how many books have you read about marriage? How many marriage preparatory seminars have you attended? How many counseling sessions have you attended? Have you submitted yourself to on the issue of marriage? How many marriage related scriptures have you studied? How many have you taken time to sit down, gather scriptures on marriage to find out what the author of marriage, God, the author of marriage, is saying about marriage? I want to inform you that this is the reason why so many marriages are failing today, because a lot of people go into the marriage oblivious and ignorant of the expectations of marriage, the requirements for marriage, and then the responsibilities in marriage. They enter into marriage only to discover that they cannot cope. That is when they begin to speak this big grammar. They now say, we are divorcing because of irreconcilable differences. But these were the two people that were, you know, over themselves, say they were in love, telling themselves all manner of things, nothing will separate me, I love you past my mother, I love you, I can die for you. And look at them now, wanting to kill each other because of wrong foundation. Now, I'll be opening the lines. If you want me to pray for you, you can call this number 0805-883-1919. 0805-883-1919. Or you can call 0805-882-1919. 0805-882-1919. Now, if you can call from now to the next 3 minutes or so, I can pick your call and then I will attend to you. We have a caller. Hello.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Good evening. Your name and where you're calling from?
I'm man of God. I'm from Imo State. My name is Peter Yaya.
Okay.
I want you to pray for me.
About what?
When I'm getting married, all the women are listening. I don't know why I'm getting up.
Can you speak up so that I can hear you well?
Okay. I'm a can you hear Igbo?
I'm going to cross one Igbo, yes. Okay, you need to also work on your let me pray for you anyway. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your son. I pray you help him in his business, whatever it is that is making him not to be seeing the money. Father, I pray you help him. I arrest every spirit of waste, every spirit of that devour your money. I pray that God will help you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 Thank you.
All right. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Your name and where you're calling from?
My name is Ubo Precious. I'm calling from Umudimune.
Okay.
I want to ask a question.
All right. Go ahead quickly.
Please, sir. There's a friend of mine that said that there's a guy that asked her hand in marriage.
Okay.
But the guy was putting it under more that he must get to know the girl detail.
That
I know having sex with her before.
Okay, not
sure that
okay,
you can take a step to forward the marriage. And she had been resisting the guy for so long time, but along the line she decided to succumb to it. And sometimes he will ask the guy, "Are you sure that after this that you not leave me and run away?" And the guy will keep on telling that because the guy just finished his service.
Okay, just ask your question because of our time. So what's the question? Sorry, what's the question now? Because we don't have much time again.
Sir?
What's your question now?
So my question here is this. Is it possible that after all this thing that the marriage will still work?
Now, the man have been sleeping with the girl, and then what happened?
Yeah, sometimes the girl, you know, she'll be thinking maybe after that, the man, the guy will just run away.
Can you reframe that question well so that I can understand it well, please?
So that they have met each other after his
is the man still with the is the man still is the man still interested in marrying the girl?
I mean, the girl told me that they were going fine, though.
Oh, sorry, you can call back, please, so that we'll hear you well. We have another caller. Hello?
Hello.
Yes, your name and where you're calling from?
I'm calling from Onitsha.
Okay.
My name is Chijoke.
All right, go ahead, Chijoke.
I want you to pray for me.
About what?
About Ross.
About?
Marriage. Ross.
Lost.
Yeah.
Okay. Father, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke that spirit of lust in the life of Chijoke. I pray you set him free. That demonic spirit, demonic desire, I rebuke it right now. I command freedom upon you in the name of Jesus. May cleansing power of God come upon your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Hello. 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 Nobody there. Okay. I'm afraid my time is fast spent, almost gone. If you want to reach me 10 minutes after this broadcast, you can call this number 0812-9544-185. I take it again, 0812-9544-185 is mine. If you can reach me in the next 10 minutes, ask your questions or your prayer requests, I'll be able to minister to you. Then I also do counseling, have counseling sessions Mondays and Tuesdays. From 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at St. Stephen's Anglican Church, Umudimune, which is very close to the traffic light. You won't miss it. Meet me there Monday or Tuesday. Come in there, tell them you're looking for the vicar, and then you'll bring it to my office and I'll minister to you. Now, I'm afraid the time is gone. Tomorrow is Sunday. Make sure you don't stay at home. And if you stay in Newe and environs, I'd like to see you tomorrow in St. Stephen's Anglican Church, Umudim, Newe, 6:30 a.m. and 9:30 a.m. Until I come your way again next Saturday by this time on this particular station, this is Venerable Arinze Anene saying to you that you are a solution to your generation. God bless you.
But I'm grateful for your mercy.
Purity FM 91.9.
Authority 91.9.
91.9.
Hi, this is Michael Jackson.
Authority 91.9 FM.
91.9 FM.
Just order me.
I bring you music.
Your music. Always a better variety of continuous favorites.
91.9.
Everyone's making the switch to more music, more Huddersfield.
News, sports, traffic, weather. You can depend on us. The News Authority, 91.9 FM. Ozubolo Newi.
Drive my money, yeah.
force you to like what you see, yeah. Because I come in peace, and I'm at peace, and that's all I need, yeah. Everything's not for everyone, and that is okay. You gotta take me as I am, I'll be better, but I'll never be somebody else. Yeah. Wherever you go, be yourself. You can never be somebody else. Yeah. Whatever you do, you better be original. No matter the pressure, be yourself. I drank a little too much, I got it from my mama. Girl, from Shola, yeah. My baby tell me, I guess it's drama. Do the best I can, cause I believe in karma. Oh, na, na, na. Maga don't pay me, no, I pay my maga. You see, now so this in me. Me, I no go force you to like what you see, yeah. Because I come in peace, so. And I'm at peace, and that's all I need, yeah. See, everything's not for everyone, and that is so good. Just take me as I am. I'll do better, but I'll never be somebody else. Yeah. Wherever you go, be yourself. You can never be somebody else. Yeah. Whatever you do, you better be true. No matter the pressure, be yourself. See, nobody perfect, no be like. I've got flaws I can't deny. But everybody getting personality. My guy make you live your life. They say we love you, but love you die. But you can never satisfy society. Society. Wherever you go, just be yourself. Whatever you do, you better be true. No matter the pressure, be yourself.
Authority 91.9 FM. Ozulu Newi.
There is fire in our eyes. All the things we say to each other are just nothing but truthful lies. I got the things that I know you wear until you choose to do me so. Oh, oh, oh. Now I see higher than the height of the mountain. Deeper than the depth of the ocean. Further than the ice. When we talk of spirituality, I see wider than the heat of the desert. Lower than the depths of the ocean. Further than the ice can see. When we talk of spirituality. Open your eyes, spirituality. Free your mind from hate, spirituality. Sure. We never got a chance
the chance to make it right. Cause right from the beginning, some people done they fight. They're fighting for the same thing, this is not bright. And brightness only come from when you see the light. Like, life is so simple, but they make it complicated. To be civilized, you don't have to be educated. Let's make it happen so with time will not be wasted. Most of the things anticipated. Like, don't trample upon another man to be elevated.
Thank you. that you're settled down and you found a girl and you're married now. I heard that your dreams came true. Guess she gave the things I didn't give to you. Old friend, why are you so shy? Ain't like you to hold back or hide from the light. I hate to come out of the blue uninvited, but I couldn't stay away. I couldn't fight it, and I hope to see your face and that you'd be reminded that for me it isn't over yet. Never mind, I'll find someone like you. I wish nothing but the best for you too.
Authority 91.9 FM.
Last night, you hit me for the last time. Last night, you show me you're no longer mine. Last night, you finally went too far. Last night, you show me who you truly are. This morning, I'm gonna pack my bag and leave. Going back to my family. Gonna find a better life for me. Maybe this morning. Gonna pick up what's left to me, and I'll be just fine, you see. Don't never try to bother me. For the last time, you took away my dignity. It was the last time you'll ever raise your hand to me. For the last time, you made me waste my tears on you. That was the last time I finally had the strength to move. This morning, I'm gonna pack my bag and leave. Going back to my family. Gonna start a better life for me. Cause see, this morning is a new morning. Gonna pick up what's left of me.
My attitude,
Now my judgment that is, I know be unbeliever. No, they ask your sister.
Authority FM 91.9.
We like it.
Uh-huh. Authority 91.9.
91.9.
Hi, this is Michael Jackson.
Authority 91.9 FM.
91.9 FM.
Just order.
I bring you music.
Your music. Always a better variety of continuous favorites.
91.9.
Everyone's making the switch to more music, more Huddersfield.
News, sports, traffic, weather. You can depend on us. The News Authority, 91.9 FM. Azubolo Newi.
Good evening, listeners. You're welcome once again to today's edition of the program, The Grail Message Hour. The Grail Message Hour is a one-hour program during which we discuss topics and unveil to you concepts based on the work in the light of truth, The Grail Message by Abdul Shane. My name is Barrister Samuel Onye, and with me in the studio this evening to take on today's discussion are, from the left,
Dr. Obiora Ejiofor, welcome to the program.
Mr. Christian Idoko, good evening, listeners, welcome to the program.
And
Mr. Jesse Ogo, good evening, listeners. Welcome to the program.
Okay. In today's edition of the program, the topic of the lead lecture is incarnation and reincarnation. What lies between? Incarnation and reincarnation. What lies between? Mr. Chris Idoko will take on today's lead lecture.
Thank you, Barrister.
Mr. Idoko.
Thank you. Incarnation, reincarnation, and what lies between. Good evening, dear listeners, once again. This is a very important topic. It will help us all understand the purpose of our coming into existence in this material world. Where we came from, where do we go from here, and what man really is. What is man? Who is man? Where does he come from? What is he doing here on this earth plane? What really is his purpose or mission here? Where does he go from here? These questions and many related ones have been asked by man himself over the ages, over the past millennia, without having definitive answers to them. I have used the noun word man in this my presentation to represent the whole of humankind. Man had pondered, meditated, contemplated, and reflected without reaching convincing answers he had approached the question from different angles, from religious, philosophical, and purely intellectual points of view, without reaching any universally acceptable answer. Sometimes he claims that he approaches them from spiritual point of views, but at the end of the day, many questions are left unanswered. Today, the existence of man on earth and where he goes after earthly death are now taken for granted, even though he does not know precisely what is his purpose here or where he is going after earthly death. Man no longer takes these questions seriously anymore. This in itself has led to a carefree situation and attitude towards life and existence in general. With all sorts of fantastic ideas, a situation that generates so much evil around us that can only find justification in sophistries and warped ideologies. Man has even reached a point where he has developed weapons of mass destruction that can wipe out all animate existence on the planet, like what the young man in North Korea is planning to do now. May the good Lord save us. It was not until the great book In the Light of Truth, the Grail Message by Abdul Rushin, came to mankind out of the grace of the Almighty God in the last century that some of us, you and I, can beat our chest and say we have an answer to most of all these pressing questions. There is no other book comparable to the Grail Message. The Grail Message, for the first time in history and evolution of man on this planet Earth, conveys a comprehensive knowledge about the origin and purpose of man on Earth, far beyond all the boundaries of existing knowledge of man from other religious and intellectual perspectives. It offers knowledge not only about man, but about creation itself as a whole, man's place and role in it, even beyond what is known as creation. It offers incontrovertible knowledge of God, the divine, the great castor, first creation, subsequent creation, and all that appertains to them. What other religious and philosophical books say about man offers only glimpses, but with uncountable blind spots. But reading and digging deep into the Grail Message in the quest of finding the origin and purpose of man offers one significant objective: conviction beyond all reasonable doubts. As my colleague here, the barrister, and his cohorts would say, let us quickly and briefly look into the origin of man. Man originated as a spirit germ from the spiritual part of creation. Indeed, from the lowest section of the spiritual part. In the Grail Message, what is known as the spiritual part of creation is so far flung that man cannot fathom it. The spirit germ can be defined and described as living or animate particles that can be regarded as residues of the continuous radiation of God. These spirit germs or particles could not gain consciousness of their own individual existence within the immediate proximity of God, that is, in the divine realm or the higher part of creation because of the high intensity of the radiations of the living light or power of the Almighty God. They have to be driven out, expelled, and forced to proceed to the much lower or cooler regions, like the prodigal son, to the lowest part of creation, far outside the divine realm, to enable them come to consciousness of their existence. Thus, consciousness is a key and component property of the human spirit gems. This consciousness has to be gained through collision and struggle with material substance of subsequent creation that is graciously prepared for and granted to the human spirits as an abode for their field of activities, while living consciously in recognition of itself and of the living God, the Almighty Father. This consciousness is in stages. A critical stage is the recognition of oneself as a living entity, recognition of oneself as a man after the images of God, independent from other creatures in the realm of nature, different from animals. The consciousness reaches the point where you and I can assert the I, the me, that is, ego consciousness, contrary to animals that cannot make such assertion. So, the higher the consciousness, the likelihood the attainment of higher recognition of God. Perhaps, I dare say, the highest point is sublimated, that is, completely humbled, superego, when you can say, without God, I cannot be. With God, I am nothing, because I am a creature of God. Conversely, you must also be able to say, without me, there is God. Without me, God is forever. Now, let us briefly look at the first incarnation of man. The first incarnation of man took place millions of years back at the midpoint of the cycle of evolution of the earth itself. The first incarnation we are talking about here is the first entrance of spirit germs into the material part of creation, that is, subsequent creation. The spirit germ, that is man, is like the mustard seed that is sowed into subsequent creation to germinate, grow, mature, and ripe for harvest by the sower. Dear listeners, you and I are such spirit gems, spirit seeds that were sown into subsequent creation to germinate, grow, but failed to mature and ripe for harvest so that we can go back to our origin in the spiritual kingdom of God. In short, back to paradise. We got stuck here on earth, and the ethereal realm going forward and backward in an endless cycle of death, incarnation, and reincarnation. Death does not lead to absolute dissolution of the human spirit into a state of nothingness or nirvana, as some people would argue or believe. Human spirit cannot dissolve into nothingness, but can only revert to its original status as a spirit germ, losing all its attained consciousness in the process. A condition that is most horrifying and painful, leading to spiritual death. Let us look at the second incarnation. incarnation which takes place within subsequent creation, that is, the material world, is the process of final entrance of the human spirit into the womb of the expectant mother at the middle of pregnancy, after acts of procreation. Please, note the first incarnation that took place at the middle point in the cycle of evolution of subsequent creation. This takes place strictly according to the law of attraction of homogeneous species, as well as other laws such as reciprocal action and spiritual gravity. It is called human soul here because the human spirit has put on several cloaks or apparels, which include the soul cloak. A human soul is often used in generic or even permissive sense to denote the status of man before or after death. But the soul cloak also wears an astral cloak, which thinly covers the soul cloak. It is the astral cloak that serves as the entry cloak into the womb of the expectant mother at the middle of pregnancy. The astral cloak easily penetrates the womb of the expectant mother, without which it is not possible to enter into the densest part of this world, that is, this earth. The final cloak is the physical one visible here on earth, that is, the incarnation of the human being or baby that we all rejoice over when the mother delivers it after 9 months of pregnancy. The physical body is like self-conscious robot with encoded genes that respond to external stimuli, driven by the force of this external stimuli, and takes nourishment in forms of food, water, and air from material substance of the earth. Reincarnation. Reincarnation, on the other hand, is the coming and going between the earth and the greater beyond, the ethereal realm, physically as a result of the failure to attain that full and highest maturity that will propel us back to paradise. Paradise is lost to us for so long because of this failure. We cannot enter paradise with a speck of imperfection still clinging to us. Thus, we wander about the ethereal realm like a lost child in the wilderness, searching for the path that leads home, stumbling and falling in exhaustion, but often summoning courage, resilience to proceed and forge ahead, hoping to reach home at last. Many causes of reincarnation: storm of life, falling of unripe fruit in the heavy storm of life. The fact of reincarnation is that it is a grace of the Almighty that gives us the opportunity or privilege of correcting ourselves through the hard schooling of life, to enable us reach perfection, to be qualified for graduation into the spiritual kingdom of God. Without this grace, we are lost. That is you and I. Dear listeners, in future episodes, I promise to delve more deeply into this reincarnation, as there are so many groups that are for and against this fact of life, as time for today's discourse will not be sufficient for that. What lies between? Man spends the greater part of his existence in the ethereal world, where the intensity of experiencing is much higher and profound than here on earth. Our earth lives are often short, are often short periods of existence. It's like snapshots, which can be interrupted at any point in time due to many factors. Thus, it could happen that we can stay in the ethereal world for more than 1,000 years before having the opportunity to reincarnate on Earth again, only to spend most probably not more than 120 years before passing on in old age, as we call it. The cycle goes on till we reach the level of perfection where we need not reincarnate again, except to proceed to higher realms until we finally reach home, back to paradise. Going back home to paradise, finding the steps that lead back home. What lies between incarnation and reincarnation are therefore our lives and accumulated experiences over the past millennia, which we carry from past incarnations or earth lives. These experiences are not easily recalled from our earthly memory. We only have snippets of them on rare occasions. Otherwise, they are completely inaccessible while on earth. But we often make use of them unconsciously because they shape our activities and destiny or fate, a situation that helps explain the varieties that we all see around us. Why you and I are not exactly the same and cannot have the same experiences, etc. In conclusion, I would like to paint an analogous picture of what we have been discussing with an experience I had on television. I once watched a comedy on television. I once watched a comedy on television, and the comedian, a female one, came out from a room to face the audience in a kind of an open hall or arena, and soon she returned to the room. What made it comedy was that each time she came out, she dressed differently, with a different makeup, different costume, and hairstyle. And this really amused the audience. What this lady comedian did was to induce laughter from the audience. And the television viewers, but unknown to her and the audience, she had given a very good picture of incarnation, reincarnation, and what lies between. At another time, another comedian came on board. This time, a male comedian. What did he offer his audience? He kept on dressing himself of different clothing. He must have undressed over a half a dozen pairs of clothes before finally appearing in a pair of boxers. Again, this second comedian presented a picture of the spirit with many coverings or cloak wrapped around it. Let us first of all unravel the picture presented by the second comedian. When our spirits left paradise, its home and starting point in its quest for development through experiencing took on one covering after the other on its downward journey, can also be called descent into the lower world. The picture represented by the second comedian undressing so many times shows what must happen to the spirit on its way upwards again. back to its starting point, paradise, in the closing of the cycle. The spirit must undress one after the other all the bodies or garments it had acquired in the course of its descent into the lower worlds, terminating on the earth plane as early stated. Now, the first comedian, her coming out from the inner room to the open hall, where a large audience awaited her, can be likened to incarnation. If we assume the open hall to be the earth plane, while the room she came out from is the great beyond, her doing that more than once, each time appearing different, with different clothing, different makeup, costumes, and hairstyle, can be likened to reincarnation, while the time between two different appearances, which she spent in the inner room and which she was not seen by her audience in the open hall, can be likened to what lies between. In closing, dear listeners, let me go back to the statement made earlier. Without God, I cannot be. Without God, I am nothing, because I am a creature of God. Conversely, too, without me, there is God. Without me, God is forever. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Doko, for that presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Now, for those of our listeners who may want to get across to us here in the studio with one question or inquiry or the other, the numbers through which you can reach us are 0805-883-1919 or 0805 into earthly existence. And that happened, like he said, towards the middle of the maturing of the earth, in the cycle of the earth, when the earth had aged halfway, half of its time of existence remaining. Everything was matured, the earthly was matured, awaiting for it. The human spirit that had taken off as a spirit gem from the spiritual had also matured during its long stay in the ethereal world and had even taken on the fine gross material body, animistic body first after the spiritual, ethereal body covering it. Then as it descends, ready for incarnation, the fine gross material body. Now he mentioned the astral body, that is the medium gross material body, which is also prepared by servants of God, lying between the waiting human spirit, now called the soul, and the body of the baby, which is in the womb of the pregnant woman. So that spirit, now called the soul, at the right time, towards the middle of the pregnancy, when the fetus, the body of the baby is prepared and matured for it, that spirit enters the womb. And after 9 months, the baby is born. That is the first incarnation. Then, after experiencing life on earth, that human spirit, that human being, dies, in parentheses. It passes on, drops the physical body, and goes back to the ethereal world, to the world beyond, to again experience life there. Now, because of the fact that he did not finish acquiring the requisite or needed experience for his maturity on earth, the threats, the laws of the Almighty Father will not let him ascend very high. He still needs to come back to the earth to experience those things he didn't experience, or to correct some errors he made while on earth. So that is where reincarnation comes in. It's an act of love of the Almighty Father to enable us to achieve the purpose of coming down into subsequent creation ourselves. So that is the summary of reincarnation, incarnation, and reincarnation. Now, Let me put one or two questions across to you gentlemen. Dr. Jaffa?
Yes.
Now, you know, Mr. Doko mentioned what lies between. That means the life of that human spirit when it has departed this world and is living in the beyond, and before it reincarnates again in another physical body for another earth life. Now, is there a connection between the law of homogeneity and where the realm of existence where that human spirit has departed earth life, where it lives its life in the beyond? Is there a connection between where it lives its life in the beyond and the law of homogeneity? That's as to whether the life it lives in the intervening period is pleasant or unpleasant.
Definitely, yes. When a soul is incarnated here on earth, he lives his earth life. While doing so, he spawn or weave threads of faith, different kinds of faith, traits of faith. Some good, some not that good, and some evil. Now, as he goes about experiencing life on earth, he creates analogous realm for himself in the beyond. You know, so he is there are power centers where he also contributes to, you know, some in the lighter realm, some in the dark realm of the beyond. And this is tied to this to the traits of faith, to these areas where he has contributed, you know, building blocks, whether of good nature of bad nature. Now that will be what will determine where he will find himself in accordance with first the law of spiritual gravity, which also work in tandem, hand in hand, with the law of spiritual homogeneity. So these laws working together, we place a human soul who departs from this earth at that exact place where he's experiencing what he has sowed, where he will now reap. Now we are talking about the third law, basic law, where he will now reap what he has sowed in the beyond, which are ethereal. You know, these things he's reaping in the world, are the things, good things or bad things of faith, which he has spawned and must be domiciled in the beyond, waiting for him. He must experience them. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, they are the ones he has also committed here through the act, through his actions that are gross material, you know, like killing, you know, people, like doing some physical evil or even physical good things. Okay? So, while in the beyond, he will be drawn to the place where exactly the justice of the Almighty and the love of the Almighty will enable him to come to recognition to what he has contributed, you know, to take responsibility of what he has contributed. Now, if he's able to take care of them, he ascend the more. But whereas he fails to take care of this responsibility, and there are other gross material trail of faith dragging him down here, he must, through recognition, through experiencing, either bitter or
pleasant,
be brought back here on this earth to continue. One earth life cannot possibly be enough. And you can find this in our school system, in our education system. That's where we got it. There is carryover. There is repeat of class, and so on. And in the Igbo cosmology, the Igbo man captures it. He says, "Onye zakoba, Okpuchayo, Omegiri, Obawanje, Obawanje. He goes through Afro to make sure that he clears the debris he has refuse he has put together and okay. make it clean.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for that explanation. And now, Mr. Go.
Yes.
Now, we have heard, and it's been conveyed to our listeners, that after the first incarnation, and the human spirit discards its physical body in earthly death, he goes to the beyond, and then because of threats of fate requiring that he will come back to the earth to learn certain things he didn't learn, or to correct some mistakes he made while he was previously on earth, he had to be incarnated on earth again as a fresh human being, born as a baby. And out of the love of the Almighty Father, we also know that his spiritual memory is blindfolded. He's not permitted to remember clearly in order to enable him to live the present earth life very purposefully and determinedly. Now, what the question I want to put to you is that in previous episodes of this program, we have mooted the fact that we have limited time in subsequent creation for our experiences, and that the judgment of the Almighty Father is intensifying, which means that for those who do not finish their maturing as is expected by the will of the Almighty Father, the judgment will catch them on the wrong foot and they will be destroyed, and then they will die a spiritual death. Yes. Now the question I want to ask you is that how do you bring in the limited time we have for these reincarnations? Is it limitless, or is there a time span explaining that we don't have all the time in the world to continue reincarnating for the purpose of correcting our mistakes on earth?
Yes. Actually, the time allotted for development of the human spirit has expired before this last time of grace, because now we are in our 12th hour. This is the time of reaping, the time of the final judgment. And this final judgment has been determined through a long period of cycle of the world of matter. So it cannot be said that every one of us have had equal number of reincarnations onto the earth plane, because so many people have reincarnated more often than the other people. But each time somebody is here, it is a very special grace. So earth life is not a question of coming here, doing a few things people do here in order to die, and you don't know whether you are going to stay with your ancestors or not. All those things are the knowledge that the average man on the street, he say, I'm going to join my ancestors, this and that. So all those type of things, man should take earth life seriously. For now, the time of reincarnation will certainly stop for so many people who have not passed a kind of spiritual exam which will allow them to come onto the earth plane again. So many people will fell out from the earth now, and they can no longer be allowed to come into the earth plane again. But so many people will also find themselves into the earth as a last grace. But if he comes here, he wants to make money, buy a Rolls Royce and do this and that, and he wouldn't know the purpose of this particular precious time. So one should really be knowledgeable to make proper use of the present time and make a beneficial use of the earth life. Now, The lead person in this presentation says that experiencing in the beyond is very intensive. Yes, experiencing in the beyond is intensive because one will only experience among homogeneous persons. You only experience the intensification of what you yourself bear, and that is brings the concept of hell. Because if it is a robber, he will be among robbers, and the intensity of robbing in every minute of their existence will bring the experience of robbery as a hell to them. So, but on the earth plane here, men of goodwill and men of evil will are given the grace to live one next each other. It's a special turning point. So, hitherto, people have been allowed to come into the earth plane. It's a special grace. Each time somebody is allowed to come into the earth, he is expected to make a very deep leap. Imagine when you can jump from your window and there is a very deep bottomless pit waiting for you. But if you can jump longer, you can make clear ground and run away. And now there is a kind of trouble. You are in this room. You are expected to make the leap. Somebody is telling you that you must leap 4 feet, for instance, across your window in order not to fall into the ditch. If the person wants to be blind, it won't take it serious. But at the end of the day, if he makes the jump and jump into the ditch, he will be finished. So eighth life is to be taken seriously, and there is a time allotted for it. For anybody who is here now, he should make serious progress. Otherwise, he will not be permitted to come into the earth again. Thank you.
Okay. The summary of what the last speaker was saying is that despite the fact that out of the love of the Almighty Father that a human spirit after the first incarnation is generally allowed to reincarnate several times for the purpose of completing his maturing, which is the purpose of his descending into the world of matter in the first place, that because the cosmic time allowed for this maturing in matter is coming to a close or has come to a close, reincarnation for the purpose of this maturing will not go on indefinitely. It is going to be determined by this cosmic clock. So if one, we are now, like the last speaker said, in the hour of 12, we are all expected to have completed our maturing. We are all expected to have come to the knowledge of the will of the Almighty Father. At least to the extent that we now know what we are supposed to do and what we are not supposed to do. So that the word of the Almighty Father will act as a judge unto us. And we know what our faults are and what our areas of strength are, so that we have a chance of passing the judgment. So reincarnation is not something that will go on indefinitely. It is circumscribed within the cosmic clock allowed by the will for human spirits to mature, to conclude their maturity on earth. Okay, now Mr. Oga alluded to the intensity of experiencing in the ethereal realm. Doc, I'd like you to say something about this. We know that the earth is very heavy in that it is physical existence. So everything is ponderous. Experiences take time to register. Whereas in the ethereal world, the physical is not there. It is lighter and more permeable, and therefore experiences register faster. I want you to link this to the intensity of experiencing in the beyond, in the ethereal world, as opposed to the slowness of experiencing here. Then number two, sir, I also want you to anyway, take this first, please.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. You In the lead lecture, the lead speaker, Mr. Idoko, did mention, the dramatist that continues to come in and goes out with different dresses, and particularly the male one that continues to undress himself up to 7 to 10 clothes. Now, if a man is incarnated in this earth, whether it is the first time or the second time, is now immaterial. He is wearing, so to speak, so many clothes. The spirit being the core essence of what we call the human being. Now, this human being, in summary, has also the spirit body, the soul body, like he said, and the substantiate, the ethereal, and so on and so forth, until we get the gross material body. We get from the woman,
the womb
of the woman, So as you are going, you will continue to leave these dresses, so to speak, this cloak. You continue to undress, continue to let it be. The earth, we must, the earthly body, we must discard here on earth, and dust goes back to the dust. The astral body, we pull together, the spirit pulls, the soul pulls the astral body out of the physical body. But doesn't take it so far. It drops it, and that one goes, and so on and so forth. That was what we bring and what used to bring about the intensity of experience. If you are in the cool region, the Eskimos, you have to get yourself well padded, so that you will be able to shock absorb the coldness and to survive. Now, if you have to go there unprepared, you have to express the intensity. Even here in Nigeria, as we are approaching the Harmattan, sooner or later you have to put on suit to go to sleep. Otherwise, you will experience the intensity of the Harmattan. So also, it is in the beyond. When you are removing these cloaks, you have the experience direct based on the region where you are experiencing. If it is lighter region, the joy will be blissful, exhilarating, and the rest of them very, very joyful. But if they are dark, woe betide you if they are dark. They are also very intense, and this could lead to spiritual death, the one we call spiritual damnation, if the soul is not able to resist the pressure of the area where he is experiencing. And if the area is a dark region, then the soul has to struggle stronger and harder in order to survive the intensity of reactions he gets from the seed he has sowed in accordance with the reciprocal action. Yes.
Oh, thank you very much. In other words, in the beyond, as opposed to what we have here on earth, human spirits or human beings will only stay in a place where human spirits of homogeneous nature and maturity are.
Yes.
If the person is a murderer, is an arsonist, is an armed robber, he will be in a dismal plane, in a dark region where human spirits of similar character also inhabit, and they will be mutually inflicting these
best passions upon themselves,
terrible passions one upon the other. Whereas if the person is somebody of a noble